I welcome you once again to Bible study this evening. We bless the name of the Lord once again for the grace He has given to us. So, as you are settling down, let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this time, for this evening, another time to look into the Word of God together with your people. Thank you, Father. We bless your holy name in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Almighty God, we are praying that this evening you will speak to us, you will bless us, you will not allow our gathering to be an mere activity. Let it be a time of encounter once again. Move us forward in understanding in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we bless you. Glory be to your holy name in the name of Jesus. Lord, teach us today in the name of Jesus Christ. Many people listening, wherever they may be listening, let your word, Lord, bless us. Let your word liberate us in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's quickly continue our discussion from where we left it in our last study. We have started the second chapter in our study book. And that is trying to find answer to the reason why we fail in our Christian journeys, in our Christian endeavors, in our quest to serve the Lord. Why we fail, and we have started identifying some of the reasons as provided by the scriptures, the reason why Christian life or Christian journey seems boring at times, reasons why at times it seems not interesting, you know, to us, seems as if we are discouraged, or it's not an interesting enterprise. The first reason we identified was that woman's strength cannot actually produce anything before God. That by strength no man will prevail. No man will prevail over self, over Satan, over sin, by strength. In other words, by human strength, by human wisdom, and trying to do that will only make one to continue struggling, and that struggle will eventually even result to failure, and that failure will result to total discouragement. The person we give up, just like we said that several people have given up on Christianity, having tried to live right, try to live well by setting some standards for themselves, by trying to do it by their strength, by their wisdom, they are failed. So they said there is no way there, that it is not possible to live a life of rest. So we prayed last week that God will allow us, give us the grace to serve Him by His own terms, not by our own terms, trying to say this is how I'm going to follow God, when God says no, I have my own way, I have my own principle, set for people who are ready to follow me, not that people will say, no, this is the way we are going to do it. We said that is just religion, that religion want to serve God, want to please God. Why Christianity is saying, no, come, let's have fellowship together. Then, as you are learning from me, how you are going to please me, you will find out. So, we prayed at that end. Now, we are going to just conclude the chapter 2 in our study today, and we will quickly go and pray. I'm going to just continue from where we stopped, by looking at the ineffectiveness of legalism. You know, we try to mention it in passing there, that woman trying to set rules and regulations so that we can please the Lord. The rules and regulations that we are setting for ourselves, you know, we want to just look at the weakness of legalism, you know, in Christianity. It's not that it is bad to set some boundaries, but those boundaries on their own cannot produce the kind of life of rest as long as it is not in line with the provisions of Jesus. So, we said that setting rules and regulations for men only have little or no impact on their lives. So the impact is very little, if at all it has any impact in our lives, especially in our inner lives, in our character, in character building, in Christian character development. We said the outward appearances are good, but if the inside is dirty, it is of no use. Now, discover that the only, maybe the little impact that legalism can actually produce in Christian life is maybe the outward show, what people can see outside, maybe as a way of putting some little check there, but actually where Christianity begins, where it begins and it originates outside, is the inside. But by the time we want to start from outside, then we trying to change the inside is a misplace of priority. So we need to begin to work on the inside before we talk about outside in Christianity, and that is the weakness of legalism. Legalism in Christianity focuses on the outward show, outward appearances, you know, trying to take good care of all of that, and not trying to see if that will affect the inside, but it's not going to work at all, according to what we are going to see today, as Jesus Christ revealed to us that legalism in Christianity is very weak. It cannot actually produce rest for people of God. All right. Now, the gospel account is full of insight about this, that during the ministry of Jesus Christ on earth, you know, he never had a good time with the teachers of the law. Talking about the teachers of the law, these are the Pharisees. Sadducees, and so on and so forth, you know, at that time. These were the respectable or respected Jewish teachers. They were members of the Jewish Council and so on and so forth. Learned people in the law of Moses, you know. And but Jesus Christ, one way or the other, never had a very good time with them, as we see in the scriptures, in the gospel account. Jesus will always rebuke them because they focus mostly on the outside, on the outward show, and you know, displaying their piety on the outside, you know, for people to see, believing that if people can keep all those laws, then they will please God. But Jesus Christ was not actually at home with their approaches. Now, so Jesus will always warn his followers against the teachings of these people, against their doctrines, because Jesus knew that that doctrine, the doctrine of the Pharisees, you know, it was a weak doctrine, that it cannot produce any rest for the people of God. So Jesus was very hard on them, and he condemned most of their activities, if not all of them. Now, let's read the book of Matthew chapter 16 for us to see that in the word of God. Matthew 16 verse 6 and verse 12. Now, it says, be careful. Jesus Christ warning his disciples there. He said to them, he said, be careful. Jesus said to them, be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And so Jesus Christ was talking in parable here, that you have to beware of the yeast, be on guard against the yeast of the Pharisees. Now, but the disciples, according to the scriptures here in verse 12, they did not understand that he was telling them, I'm reading verse 12, then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against the yeast used in bread, but against the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees. Of course, there is a place in the scripture that Jesus Christ said, little yeast will make the whole flour to rise. In other words, now the teaching of the Pharisees, no matter how small it is, it has a way of damaging a lot of things in somebody's life, in somebody's Christian life, you know, way of making you to be legalistic about your, you know, Christianity. And you discover that one of the injunctions of God to the Israelites, to the Jewish people, was that they shouldn't put yeast in their flour, in their dough. They eat unleavened bread, especially whenever they want to do the Passover. It has to be done with unleavened bread, in other words, bread that has no yeast. And you know, because that was what happened, when they were doing passing over from the Egypt to you know, to be on their journey to the promised land. And so it became a tradition among them that they don't put yeast in their dough or their flour. Now Jesus Christ is now using that look, when you listen to these Pharisees, when you listen to their legalistic approach to life, you discover that it's like you are putting yeast inside your dough, you know, and you are going to rise beyond measure. You will think that you have arrived. You will think that you are doing something great. you would think that you are the most most pious person among people. And that is, legalism. Just like these Pharisees, they believe that every other people are not holy, are not serving God, until they accept, they obey the laws, of Moses. They cannot be righteous before the Lord. An example is found in the place that we cited the other time, that when Paul was trying to challenge them, that look, circumcision is nothing. What is the most important thing is the new creation. Now that happened in Galatia, that these people wanted to enforce circumcision on the people of on Christians there. The Greek Christians, they wanted to enforce them for circumcision because they believe that if you don't do that, don't keep that that law, you are not going to be acceptable before the Lord. And that, in a way, gives these Pharisees sense of arrival, that yes, we are the most pious people than anybody that is not following these rules, so this tends to create some pride in people. Legalism tend to put some level of pride in Christian life, because you'll be looking at yourself as if, having followed all these rules, other people that couldn't do that, they are not holy. Then you rise beyond measure. So that's what flour does in bread. It makes it to rise. But you see, when it rises, it becomes light. You can see there are some bread that you see now that when you press them like this, you discover that the only thing inside is just what? Here. So the bread, it has no weight, because it just rises by the help of the yeast. And that is how some Christians are. Most Christians that are obeying, that are too legalistic in their approach to Christianity, it is that legalism that made them to rise like that. On the inside, they have nothing. They are very, very dirty on the inside. In fact, they are light on the inside. If you see a flower that has no yeast, and the one that they have put yeast, you discover that the one that has no yeast tend to be heavier than the one that have the yeast. Now you can see now that legalism tend to make somebody to be pompous, to rise. You will rise, look big, appear before men as if you are okay since serving the Lord. But it just, and you discover that on the inside, several of those people are light. They are very light. And so you see that. But those who are plain on the inside, you see then that spiritually they may appear not to be nobody before people, but they are working on the inside. They do not allow the yeast of hypocrisy to rise them up. They want to sort things out in line with the injunctions of the Spirit of God of the Bible. So more reason why Jesus Christ said be careful. He said he had to warn them, be careful. That he says, he now said, be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and Sadducees. You can see that legalism tends, this is what legalism tends to do in our life. It damages our relationship with God. It doesn't allow us to depend on God. It tends to make us proud, because we will have relied on all those laws, that once we keep them, we keep the law, we do that, though they are good, tends to say, yeah, I am okay. Just like the parable of Jesus Christ about two people that went to pray in the temple. One was a publican or whatever, and one was just saying that, yeah, I keep the law, I pay my tithe, I do everything. But the other one say, have mercy upon me, O a sinner. And the Bible says, the one that have mercy upon me, the one that did not appear heavy, he appeared the way he is in God's presence and said, Lord, if you don't help me, I am finished. But the other one who was keeping the law, who appeared to be very big, you know, but he was the one that is actually light. You can see the difference there. That same. So Jesus Christ warned us, you know, against that legalistic approach in serving the law. It's not going to produce the life of rest that we are trusting the Lord for in our lives. Now, so Jesus said, what I'm talking about is the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees. So, to show to you that legalism is dangerous. It's very, very dangerous. It's dangerous in Christianity. It can produce rest. There are several rules and regulations that we have been hearing a lot. We'll discover that at the end of the day, on the inside, it doesn't do anything for the people. So the errors that the teachers of the Lord were committing is that that Jesus Christ did not agree with. We can go ahead and read that all again in the book of Matthew 23 to really see the ordeal of Jesus Christ, the encounter of Jesus Christ, where he really dealt with the Pharisees in his discussion there, to show to us that the reason why he said we should be careful of legalism as in our Christian life, as we are trying to find out how do we follow Jesus Christ and have rest and have peace in life here. Then look at Matthew 23:1-5. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, the teachers of the law and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. Look at one of those things. The first thing is that they sit in Moses' seat. In other words, they really, really cherish the law of Moses. He sits in a very exalted position. So you must obey them and do everything they tell you. That's one of the, what legalistic people do. The people must obey them and do everything they tell the people. They are lords because they are the custodian of the law of Moses, and because they have studied the law in and out, and they need to actually enforce it on the people. But look at what Jesus Christ, he said, but do not do what they do. These people will tell you that everything we are telling you to do, you must do it too. But do not do what we do. And I say, for they do not practice what they preach. Now you can see that legalism allows for you to do anything as long as you just obey rules. Look, I say these people, these Pharisees, they don't practice what they preach. Now you discover that majority of the people that are teaching them obey the people today. Obey this, obey this. You see several people who will tell people that they should fast while they themselves are not fasting. You will see some people who will say people should pray while they are not praying. You will see some people who will tell people that read your Bible, read your Bible, read your Bible, but they are not reading their own Bible. You will see some people who tell people, come for prayer, come for this, come for that, but they too, they will not be there. Can you imagine that? So you can see that that is one of those things that the Pharisees are doing today. Look at it. He said, they tie up heavy loads and put them on men's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. You see, they tie up heavy loads and put them on men's shoulders. You know, so legalism makes life difficult for people. In fact, legalism makes Christianity difficult. It makes life difficult for people. You can see that there are several so-called people, preachers, leaders today, sorry to see, who in their bid to lead people to be legalistic about things, they are actually making Christianity difficult for people. That you must do this, you must do that. If you don't do this, if you don't do this, then people will say all these laws. Who will obey all this one? Who's going to obey all this one that these people are giving to us? They say, well, if that is what it takes, we are not going to. So when the first time that people come to church, it is rules and regulation will be counting, will be laying down for them. Of course, there is nothing wrong with trying to put some controls there. But we need to be very, very careful so that we will not make Christian life difficult for people. Now, say these people they put a heavy load and put it on men's shoulders, but they themselves are not willing to lift a finger to move them. So you can see that those majority of these rules that people actually place on people's shoulders, some of them, they don't obey those rules. That is the life of Pharisees for you. Now Jesus said everything they do is done for men to see. You can see now that they are very pious on the outside, very, very pious, very, very holy. They obey all the rules, they go to temple activities, they don't miss services, they don't miss time of meeting and so on and so forth. They can organize prayers here and there all every time. They do everything for men to see. Now you can see that one of the weakness of legalism is that it protects what men can see. It's just for men to see that this brother is doing well. Even when they want to pray, it is for men to see. Whenever if they want to give, it is for men to see. They want to sing, they want to do anything, they want to, it is for men to do what? To see. These are the attributes of Pharisees and teachers of the Lord, and that is legalism. Now they make their cycletries wide and tassels on their garment long. In other words, that's the dressing, the way they dress, and the cycletries, some of those things that Jewish people use during prayers, and their tassels on their garments. Those are their garments should have tassels, and they make their home very, very long, that people will know that these are very, very pious people and committed leaders of the law. And so just to show, because for men to see, so that when people see their home, they say, these people are very, very pious people. And this shows to us that what really matter is not all this. It's not the outward show at all, but where God is actually focusing most of the time is the inside. Let the inside be all right, then we can talk about the outside. Now, according to the argument of Jesus in the verses above, the major attribute that described the Pharisees, like we have been saying, it was legalism. They enforced men to obey the law of Moses. They use force. It is by force. You just must obey it. If not, that's going to be a problem. They put every yoke of rules and regulations they must obey on them. Now, what they do is that they make outward appearance a priority for holiness. Now, that's pure legalism. When we make the outward appearance a priority for holiness, and that is a negation of the life of rest. Holiness, the priority of holiness is inward, it is inward it is inward concentration. Holiness begins from the inside. Unlike the people of the Pharisees who refused it and say no, let's start from the outside. But Jesus Christ said no. Christianity say no, we have to start from the inside. When the inside is good, then we need to talk about the outside. Now, what Pharisees do, or the legalism does, is that they want to heal the wound from the outside. A wound that is already decayed, a life that is already decayed by sin, by Satan. Now, the Pharisees, or legalism, comes around and say, no, what we'll do is that let's begin to heal it from the outside. But Jesus Christ said, no, that's not how to do it. We have to go inside where the decay is and begin the healing process from the inside. Then the healing will be coming from the inside, then the outside will be healed. That's the kind of, and that is when there's going to be rest. Because if the wound is healed on the surface, the pains, the decay is inside. It will continue to rotten on the inside, and the person will never be at rest. Everybody will say, what happened now? Your wound is healed now. But the person will say, no, I'm still feeling some pains. They say, where? I say, on the inside. On the inside. Just like when somebody has an accident and he says, I'm okay, there's no problem. And if care is not taken, the person might have suffered some internal injury or internal, maybe have internal bleeding. And that is much more dangerous than the external bleeding. So the person needs to be checked. So the person, it will say, no, I'm okay. But if there are internal bleeding, the person can drop dead anytime. And that is what the law, the Pharisees, the lower legalism does, trying to heal the wound from the outside. So to the outside, once the outside is all right, this person is good. But God, Jesus Christ said, that cannot produce rest. And that's it. The life of rest, the healing, our healing process as people of God should start from the inside. If we really, really want healing, if we want peace, if we want rest in life, our healing process must begin from where? From the inside. Let's pray that God will begin to heal us from the inside in the name of Jesus. So people will say, yes, Christianity is not only on the inside, it's outside also matters. Yes, we agree, but one has to take priority. Let's start the inside first. Don't let us talk about the outside if we have not actually worked on the inside. It is when the inside is actually dealt with, then that the outside can be all right. Then there can be proper healing. Now, let us notice that Jesus was addressing the crowd and his disciples in this discussion. This indicates that the situation of the people of Israel as at the time was that of people who had been subjected to legalisms, laws that could not make them perfect. Now, Jesus was actually addressing not only the disciples in this matter, he was addressing the crowd, and he was actually alerting them, educating them about the ineffectiveness of the law. He was educating them about what that the law could not make anybody perfect. He was not rubbishing the law, but he was telling them that, look, we need to begin the process from the inside. Then, on the outside, the law can take over that one. Now, let's look at verse 15. Look at what verse 15 says here. It says, woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees. So you can see that Jesus Christ never actually took it. It was a serious matter. He didn't take it lightly with them. He said, woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees. Pharisees, you hypocrites. Look at that now. You can see that legalism, if thanks to turn people to hypocrites, well, trying to, once you obey the outward, every other thing, you know, trying to heal people from the outside, from the, you know, is hypocrisy. Trying to do your Christianity from the outside, trying to reach God from the outside, not working on the inside, it is hypocrisy. He said, you travel over land and sea to win a single convert. Now, see that you can do anything to win convert, to bring people to church, it doesn't matter. Everything can still result to legalism. It doesn't matter the style, the approach that we use to bring people to church, to do everything, and so on and so forth. And then you now say when it becomes one, you know that you people can do anything, you can travel to anywhere to win a soul, to win a convert, you know, bring a disciple. And when you bring the one, when the person now becomes a disciple, say you make him twice as much a son of hell as you are. You can see that legalism, trying to force people to serve God, will not work. Trying to heal the wound of the people from the outside is not going to work. Where the decay is the inside. That is where the healing process should begin. So, people of God, we need to concentrate more on our inner life if we want to actually obtain the life of rest, so that we will not just be bleeding on the inside and people will think that outwardly that we are being healed, or that we are okay with God. We have to look inward and let God deal with us every internal rottenness in our souls, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that we will not be serving God like Pharisees and the Sadducees. There's this place in that 23 that is, we call these people, if you read down, we call them whitewash sepulchre. You know that was white, a very beautiful tomb. You know, when they bury people on the inside, there is rottenness. It will be rottening on the inside. Maggot will be eating the person on the inside. But on the tomb, there will be a lot of decoration, a lot of everything. You know, they will dress the people, will put flowers. Some people can dress the tomb in order to keep the memory of the people. But on the inside, hey, a lot of decay. Now that is hypocrisy. That is the life, the picture of legalism, the picture of trying to follow the Lord in a legalistic manner, trying to obtain, you know, healing, rest from the outside, trying to do that from the outside without looking at the inside. Allow the healing process to come from within us. It's called those people whitewash sepulchre, because that is what they do. They dress the outside is good, and the inside is rottenness there. So the life of rest we are talking about can never be achieved if the concentration is actually on the outside, and that it is not starting from the inside. Then the outside, the inside can take care of that. Now, Jesus saw people that have been harassed. Now, you can see what legalism does for Christians is to harass them. You know, it's harassment. There are several people that have been harassed. You know, Christianity does not say that we should be harassed. A lot of harassment here and there, trying to obey the law that is set up by people. You know, these people have been harassed. They have been messed up, trying to meet up, and they cannot meet up. You know, are you in that situation that you feel harassed as you are trying to follow Jesus? It's like you are struggling and you can't meet up with it. Now, maybe you have resorted into trying to heal your wound from the outside. Stop it. Go inside. All those rottenness, let the healing process begin from within. That's how to heal a rotten wound, you know. Now, so these people have been harassed and battered. Now, Jesus saw that some men that needed rest from burdens men have subjected subjected them to. So Jesus Christ, as Jesus Christ was speaking to the crowd and the disciple, was seeing people that needed rest. Maybe you need the rest from the internal injuries that you have suffered, internal rottenness that have been going on. The Lord is going to do it if you can allow him today. Now that is why Jesus warned the apostles to take heed and beware. Now you can see that we need to take heed and beware that we don't do our Christianity from the outside. Let it start from the within, then the outward will be sorted out. Now, ordinary warning, as much as Jesus Christ is doing this, however, ordinary warning for Jesus was not going to liberate men from the life of unrest. He needed to provide a sure way of escape. Now, we are going to stop here today. Now, our question for the next study is that if woman strength and legalism cannot achieve the life of rest, then what is the secret? That's what we are going to be concentrating on as we begin. If Jesus Christ, if the teaching, if be careful or whatever teaching and warning is not going to be enough for Jesus, then what are those things that he did or he wants us to do? Now, our question will be, how do we enter practically without being mechanical? Because we have said that legalism is mechanical. To be trying to be legalistic, trying to heal wound from the outside, is mechanical. It is legalism. You know, it's a mechanical approach to serving the Lord. So how do we enter practically, but we are not being mechanical, we are not struggling into the abundance of life of rest that Jesus promised? These are the questions. Then how do we find Christianity easy to practice and enjoyable in this present age? So we are going to, as we conclude, that is where we are going to pick it up. What is the way out? What is the provision of Jesus even for us to have the life of rest that we are looking for? So we will pick it up from there as we go into the next chapter in our next study. So I pray that the Almighty God will give us understanding in the name of Jesus Christ. Your prayer is this: do you have any internal wound that you have been trying to heal from the outside? Do you have any bleeding, spiritual bleeding? On the inside, you can feel some rottenness, that you are not just happy, you are not just at peace, at rest as a child of God. Stop trying to be legalistic. Stop trying to appear as if you are okay while the inside is not good. Why don't you invite Jesus Christ to help you to come inside and pack out all those rottenness? Then let the healing process begin through the oil of the Holy Spirit. So when the inside is healed and all the rottenness is packed away, then the healing will begin process gradually. And when the healing process in your heart is complete, then outwardly you will shine like a Christian. Your life will shine, and everybody will see that you are a child of God. Your light will shine, your Christianity, your character and conduct will be evident to everybody that you are a child of God. Do you want us to pray together here? Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, today for this time. Lord God Almighty, we pray that you will do your work in our spirit. We invite you into our soul, O God, to come in. We want to stop our doing Christianity, healing, or seeking for healing from the outside. We want to stop it. That is legalism. Lord, let the healing process in our lives, oh Lord, from today, let it begin from our soul. Let it begin from the spirit. Every rottenness, let your spirit, oh God, remove them and heal us from within in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord God Almighty, let this word, oh God, be interpreted in our souls. Let it do what you have sent it to do today, and your name be glorified. Thank you, Father. We bless your holy name. In the name of Jesus Christ, we have prayed. God bless you.